Hello there, and welcome to another episode of A Scouting 5, recapping scouting news from around the world for the week of August 10th, 2020. I'm Scouter Ken, and I am once again recording from St. Albert, Alberta. The volunteers who maintain Camp Stone hope to convey to their community that the park is closed by order of Scouts Canada due to the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. They are having issues with this, however, they've been seeing trespassing, littering, and parking at their gate access. Camp Stone is a Scouts Canada property. It's 125 acres of wilderness camp, which is actually located within the city limits of Kimberley, British Columbia, just past the entrance to the Riverside Campground. Scouts in Kimberley first started using the property around 1929. Back then, it was owned by Cominco. Later, it was owned by Tech Resources, and Scouts Canada leased the property from them. The First Kimberley Group Scouts, as a group of volunteers, are not legally the owners of any property, so Camp Stone, as well as Resker Hall in nearby Marysville, are now managed by Scouts Canada Properties Trust of British Columbia and the Yukon, which is a holding company. Camp Stone, it's a heavily forested wilderness camp. There's not a lot of development there. There's like a small cabin, a longhouse with a kitchen, fire pit, and some outhouses during regular operation before Scouts Canada closed all of their properties nationwide. It was used for weekly program meetings for Scouts, as well as, of course, for camping, and it's also played host to larger camps, as many as 400 to 500 kids in attendance at a time. According to volunteers, some people are simply just walking through the camp to go for a walk, but under the current directives from Scouts Canada, that is actually forbidden, and that's not the main reason people go. The main reason they go is for access to the river. Volunteers say they've been picking up litter, dog excrement, and cigarette butts. They've not seen any vandalism this year, thankfully, but over the course of many decades, that has happened as well. Currently, the biggest concern that volunteers have is the risk of fire from the aforementioned cigarette butts. The RCMP have stated they won't be arresting anybody for this, but they still encourage people to report any observed acts of trespassing so that they can remind offenders that the property is closed and that they shouldn't be there. And moving over to Victoria, British Columbia, a bottle drive fundraiser was held over the weekend in support of Scouts Canada's Camp Barnard, and this was at the View Royal Canadian Tire in Victoria proper. The 100-hectare camp, Camp Barnard, which is usually a hub of activity over the summer, has, like all other Scouts Canada properties, faced an extended closure due to the coronavirus pandemic. The 30th Baden-Powell Guild held a bottle drive to support the camp, which of course is going to be losing a lot of revenue this year due to its closure. No contact and sorting were required. People could just drive up and eager Scouts would happily unload bottles from their vehicles for them. The official committee representing abuse survivors in the Boy Scouts of America's ongoing bankruptcy case is asking a judge to void real estate transfers by a local Boy Scouts council in Tennessee, saying that they violated court restrictions on sales or transfers of BSA assets. The committee's court filing late last week came roughly a month after it sent a cease and desist letter to the Middle Tennessee Council, although it didn't actually get a response from the council. And according to the filing, the council transferred several of its properties, including the Boxwell Reservation, the Latimer Reservation, Grimes Canoe Base, and the Parrish Reservation camp properties, as well as its Nashville office building, to an irrevocable asset protection trust. This would have been back on July 1st. Those trusts are typically established to shield assets from creditors, and the committee believes that the council took similar steps to shield its cash and deposit account assets as well. The trustee for the properties is the council's vice president of properties, and he's also Tennessee's state transportation commissioner. Just to add to the complexity of this whole thing. The community argues that under BSA's charters and bylaws, the national organization has a revisionary interest in local council properties. Under those rules, then, if a local council's charter is revoked or if it lapses, the property and cash would be turned over to the BSA after any claims against the council are satisfied. So the committee's contention is that the transfers have violated the automatic stay included in the Chapter 11 bankruptcy proceedings, which would halt collection activities and otherwise protect the assets of a debtor. The BSA, for their part, contends that the transfer of the properties doesn't affect its reversionary interests at all. A 34-year-old man is currently in jail in Garland, Texas, after stealing a trailer from the Boy Scouts of America in nearby Plano. According to the Garland Police Department, officers were investigating the suspect, one Stephen Cook, who allegedly attempted to sell the stolen trailer on OfferUp, I assume that's a sales website of some kind, back in June. Cook had evidently been observed at a gas station in the 3000 block of South Jupiter Road in a red Dodge Ram pickup on August 10th, shortly before midnight, and they lost sight of him, but were evidently subsequently able to catch up to him and arrest him. Historian Peter Raymond would like to pinpoint exactly when, between the years 1951 and 1955, the Gladwayna sailed into the town of Larne in Northern Ireland. According to the good Mr. Raymond, the Gladwayna was manned by a troop of Sea Scouts from Newcastle upon Tyne, called the First Tyne Sea Scouts. He's been compiling data to help write a history of that troop for the benefit of its current members and old hands, some of whom are still alive. The troop was started in 1913, which makes it over 100 years old now, and he's hoping that his efforts will serve to attract additional interest in the group, enough to keep it going. Unfortunately, he's been finding that memories are a little bit hazy, and there's some disagreement as to when Larne was visited. Would have occurred in the month of August in any of the years mentioned above, 1951 through 55, probably in the latter half of the month. Any help would be appreciated, and he would note any contributions in the history that he ultimately writes. So if you're interested in helping out with this research, if you have some roots in the Larne area and you're aware of the history of the visit of this boat to that town, you can actually email news at larnetimes, that's L-A-R-N-E times.co.uk, and they will relay the information to Mr. Raymond. And that is all the news I have for you this week. So thank you again for listening. And until next time, be prepared.